And how are you on this Lord's Day? It is spring, the sun is shining, and we are in God's house to worship Him. Let's celebrate our Savior today. Let's take time, not just to contemplate, but to also to express our love for our Lord, to express the joy that He gives to us. Of course, let's think. Let's think more deeply than we have other times during the week about eternal matters, about things that pertain not only to life here on this earth, but life in eternity. And let's take God's word and see how we can apply it to ourselves. Later today, I'll be preaching from the book of Jude. Where's the book of Jude? Well, it's at the very end of your Bible. It's the next to last book in the Bible, just 25 verses. And we're going to be taking a look in the next few weeks at that book of Jude. But let's start this morning by singing of our love for Christ. My Jesus, I love thee. Let's stand up and let's sing. Father, we thank you for a new day, a day in which we can begin the week by worshiping you. by joining our hearts, our voices, our minds together to give you the glories and to glean understanding of the God who created us and saves us, the God who demands our devotion, who has gotten our attention. We pray, Lord, that you will take our hearts and mold them into your image. Use us, Lord, we pray this morning, but speak to us as well. And may you be glorified. Amen. Please be seated. We have some announcements for you this morning. The first one regarding tomorrow. Tomorrow's a big day, apparently. And I'm just surprised at how many people are excited about the eclipse. Right? And we're going to celebrate the eclipse tomorrow. 2:30 for those of you who are in town. We'll be outside looking at the sun, of course, with NASA-specific rate glasses, right? So if you want to bring your box of Cheerios and look through that, that's up to you. But so come bring your glasses. If you don't have glasses, we do have a few extras, just a few. And it would be good to be able to just look at the wonders of nature as the eclipse happens. At 2:30 tomorrow, I think it will fully happen, as much as we'll see, at around 3:30. So we'll watch as the sun gets clouded over by darkness. How dark will it get in Wantage? Well, that's tomorrow, 2:30. Hope you can make it. Also, this week on Wednesday, we have online, we have our prayer group, and we would love for you to join us, and we can pray. Listen, even if you can't join us, we would like to pray for you. So if there's anything that we can pray for you or someone that you know is in need of prayer, just let us know. Send an email to the office, and we'll put that on the prayer list as well. Very good. So that's Monday, Wednesday, and now in May, the 4th of May, I believe that's the first Saturday, it's Mulch and Window, Love Your Church Day. For those of you who don't like mulching, listen, you can do windows. And we have plenty of windows to clean. It's always good to get these windows clean as the spring comes in. But also we want to get rid of the weeds and just make the grounds look better. So if you can help mulch as well, listen, it's not just for you guys. I've seen some of you women mulch, and you do a really good job. Personally, I'm a windows guy, but no, I'm just kidding. But you are more than welcome to come and help. That will be at 8:30 on May 4th, 8:30 on May 4th. All right. That following Sunday, after our worship service, we will have a lunch and a brief congregational meeting down. Now, ladies, there's been a change in plans this year in regards to the women's retreat. Often you guys, you ladies go to out towards Scranton. This year you're going locally to the Tri-State Christian Camp by Port Jervis, just on the other side of the mountain. And that will be April 12 and 13. I know some of you would prefer to stay overnight. Many of you would want to just come home that Friday and go back Saturday morning. It's up to you. If you have any questions, please speak to my wife and she could fill you in. The theme is Master Designer. You could go on their website as well. There's in your worship folder, there's a little advertisement for it. You could go on their website and see for yourself what's going on and what the rates are. But I'm sure it will be a good time together as you spend a weekend together under God's word. Very good. For those of you who donated to today's Choice Pregnancy Center, thank you, they say. Nearly $1,300 in those little bottles, and that will help. Now, they were hoping to raise more. I think they were looking for somewhere like $50,000, and they were a bit short of their goal. So let's see what happens in the next coming months. We sure want to make sure that they stay viable and that they have the funds they need. So it's something for us to pray about, isn't it? But thank you for those $1,300 that you donated to them. Yes. Very good. I mentioned Monday, I mentioned Wednesday. On Thursday, rather Wednesday morning, True Hope Bible Study, a Bible study for our county elected officials. We appreciate your prayers. We get together, two pastors and a congressman get together, and we lead a Bible study for elected officials, people who are voted into office here in our county. They come together. Some, very few, are believers in Christ. Others are just seeking answers, looking for an understanding as to why we are who we are and how should we lead our county. What does the Bible say? What are the implications for us? So it's a wonderful breakfast every other Wednesday on the second and fourth Wednesday of the month. If you will remember, if you can remember to pray for us at 7:30 on Wednesday, I would be very, very grateful. And then on Thursday night online, we have Gateway Theological Institute. That is 7:30 online, and the church, whoever wants it, gets a link, and you could jump in and join the students that are there for the last few years. And one more announcement. You know, last Sunday when we were here worshiping the Lord, it was a wonderful time under His Word and celebrating the resurrection. The Church of Christ met around the world, right? And as the clock moved across the scope of this globe, different churches met at different hours. Well, at the same time that we were meeting, the church in Cuba was meeting. And this is what was happening there. A few pictures. They sent almost 85 pictures, actually. So these are just six. And they, too, were worshiping the Lord. When I've been going to Cuba, this is usually where I end up, in that one place there. It's a church building that the pastor said looks like una aula, which means a chicken coop, because there are no walls, there's just a fence. And in Cuba, it's warm all year round, and so that's not a problem. I find it interesting because right outside of each of those fences are people's homes. And every Sunday, they all hear very loudly what's going on in the church service. It's good to see all these people, 15 in all, were baptized last Sunday. As we met here, they were meeting there, preaching the Word of God. It's good to know that we're not alone. I know you knew we were not alone, but at times it's good to see who's joining us. As we raise up our voices, open our hearts to the Lord, there's others simultaneously around the world doing likewise. God is building His church. Thank the Lord for what they're doing in Cuba. It's a destitute place right now. It's a place none of us here would want to live because it's so destitute. The situation there is so poor that if you were to have surgery in Cuba, you have to bring your own rubber gloves, your own suture set, and your own light bulb so the doctors could see what they're doing. That's how bad things are there. And yet, do you see any sad faces there? That's because they rejoice in the Lord. Their hope is in Christ, not in their nation, not in their government. The hope is in the Lord. So praise God for that. I look forward to being able to go again. There's been some dates offered, but nothing seems to be working yet. So let's see what happens, what the Lord works out. Very good. Those are all the announcements. Quite a few of them, I realize that. Let's get back into the business of worshiping our Lord as we read the book of Jude.
Good morning. Sorry about that. The book of Jude. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. May mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people, who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now I want to remind you, although you once fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. And the angels, who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desire, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. Yet in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Woe to them, for they walked in the way of Cain and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error and perished in Korah's rebellion. These are hidden reefs at your love feasts, as they feast with you without fear, shepherds feeding themselves, waterless clouds swept along by winds, fruitless trees in late autumn, twice dead, uprooted, wild waves of the sea, casting up the foam of their own shame, wandering stars, for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. It was also about these that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of his holy ones to execute judgment on all and to convict all the ungodly of all their deeds of ungodliness that they have committed in such an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loud-mouthed boasters, showing favoritism to gain advantage. But you must remember, beloved, the predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. They said to you, 'In the last time there will be scoffers, following their own ungodly passions.' It is these who cause divisions, worldly people, devoid of the Spirit. But you, beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt, save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen."
Please rise. Come behold the wondrous mystery. Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He's the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold, oh, the wondrous mystery. He, the perfect Son of God, In his living, in his suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in him we stand. Come behold the wondrous mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree. In the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death of the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain him, praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we live
seated. And open in your scriptures once again to the book of Jude. The book of Jude is the next to last book in your New Testament, in your Bible. And we are going to venture into what is probably the most overlooked book in the New Testament. It's only 25 verses long. It is not the shortest book in the New Testament. 3 John would be the shortest with only 15 verses. This here is 25. And as you know, these books in the Bible, these epistles, were letters written to particular people or particular churches. And if this letter was to be written today, it would probably be in a form of an email, and it would be a rather long email. But as a biblical book, as by biblical standards, this is a very short book. And the book here, you'll notice very quickly, if you haven't already, as Gabe read it to us, the book is about contending for the faith that has been given to us, that has been entrusted to us. Contending for the faith, fighting for the faith. And in the process, maybe you saw this, if you haven't, you will eventually. In the process, as he makes his way through these 25 verses, he reminds us that the church is the pillar of truth. Just as Paul told Timothy, we're reminded here again of how important it is that the church holds on to the truth of God. And he tells us that we must know what we believe. It also, here in the book of Jude, reminds us that we ought to learn from the past. The past should be a teacher for us. And is even here a call to be merciful to those who don't learn from the past. And to help those who don't believe, be merciful to those who don't believe. Ultimately, Jude reminds us of who is in charge: Christ himself. It's an important book for us to consider that Christ is ultimately the one who will have his way as we go about our business, not only living from day to day, but looking to present ourselves holy and acceptable to God by how we live and by the fact that he's taken us and redeemed us. He's washed us. We see here the rewards of redemption, don't we? That God will take his own and keep his own, protect his own, that God will use his own. So with all this in mind, we are to contend for the faith. We're supposed to fight, to struggle for the faith that's been entrusted to us. And I think in order to be able to better understand what Jude is saying here, we need an introduction. So all I'm going to do this morning is introduce to you some essentials to this little book that we have here in the New Testament. I'm going to give you some specifics in regards to the purpose of the book, and then in regards to the author and of course who he's writing to. So let's begin with the beginning here, the purpose of Jude. This short letter does not waste any time. Jude tells us exactly and very quickly why he is writing. Look there at verse 4. He says, "For certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ." There's no mixing of words here. Now, Jude's original intention was quite different. This is not what he was looking to do originally. This is not what he was going to write about originally. And though we do not know exactly who he's addressing, notice he doesn't tell us, we do know that this letter here is very fitting for the early church. We see the same sort of problem described there in verse 4. We see it happening in the church in Galatia. We see it happening in the church in Colossae. The church in Thessalonica had the same problem. And you'll recall, we were just looking at 1 Timothy. Remember, the church of Ephesus had the same problem. People infiltrating and twisting the truth as they lived out their lives in the church. We have the same problem being addressed in 1 and 2 John as well. So it's a common problem. And what we discover as we read through this book and we look at the church, the modern church, the church today, we see that the same thing is happening for us today, to us. And so this letter here is equally fitting for the church today. It's not just for the church 2,000 years ago. It's very much for today's church. Now, what we see in verse 3 is that Jude originally wanted to discuss the wondrous salvation they shared in Christ. He says, "Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints." That was his original intention, to talk about their shared salvation. He wanted to elaborate on those wonderful truths that bolster up our faith. He wanted to write to them as a means of encouraging them to persevere in their faith, an encouragement for their countenance and to move them to rejoice more in the Lord. He wanted to remind them of those great truths that serve as a mooring by which they can dock their lives and not find themselves drifting further away into despair and threat. That's what he wanted to do. But there's an urgent problem here, an urgent matter that needs to be addressed. And so that's what he does. It's a matter that needs to be addressed in order to understand what he says, our common salvation, the salvation that we have in common as people of God, as the church. If these infiltrators are allowed to continue, is what Jude is saying, our common salvation is going to become distorted. And so we must address this because we don't want these people having come into the church to distort our common salvation. And Jude wants to talk about the danger of those certain people, in his words, certain people who have crept in unnoticed. And he describes them this way. He says, they are ungodly people, verse 4. They pervert the grace of God, and they deny Jesus Christ. And he writes with a very serious, did you notice? Very serious and assertive authority. And maybe this is one of the reasons why the book of Jude is so overlooked. It's not a comfortable book to read. You don't get goosebumps when you read Jude. And notice something about what he's writing and how he's writing. Jude is not so much disappointed with the church. Rather, there's a dread for the church, a fear for the church. He's alarmed more than he is saddened. And so there's this urgency, a pressing need. There's a sense of consternation with every verse. There's not a panic, but there is an alarm. Not anguish, but distress, yes. No anxiety, but there is deep concern for the church of Christ, as he writes. And so this is a call to action. He says, contend for the faith. Don't just sit there any longer. Don't just sit there and listen, but fight for the truth. Contend for the faith. We need to be people of action. And you'll notice that in all the examples cited before, Galatia, Ephesus, Thessalonica, you'll notice that in all those examples, the local church tends to find a way to accommodate false teachers. Isn't that amazing? We not only allow them, but often we accommodate them. I find that hard to understand, but it is the reality. Somehow we find these teachings to be acceptable, if not completely truthful. They are willing to embrace and welcome these false teachers with their false teachings, as if these false teachings are innocuous. Oh, it's not a big deal. As if their intent, and the intent of these false teachers, was harmless. And Jude is saying, no, it's not harmless at all. You know what I think as I read through the book of Jude? I often think that the church sounds more like the Beatles than they do Jesus Christ. And when it comes to false teachings, we say, hey, Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. We seem to be oblivious to the danger of bad teachings. And then all of us join together and say nothing. Na-na-na-na. Na-na-na-na. Hey, Jude. In other words, Jude, come on, lighten up a little. This is not so bad. Don't stress out. Live and let live. But Jude underscores the problem. And he says, we have here a very serious danger, a very serious threat. Have you noticed, historically, that whenever the church faces oppression from the outside, she multiplies? Go back in history and look at how many times governments have tried to oppress and stop the church. And what's the result? The church multiplies. When governments burn Bibles, the people find more. When the church is browbeaten and subjugated, forced into hiding, what happens? She grows. The church does not face extinction from outside forces. No, not at all. The greatest danger to the local church are diabolical teachings from within. Those diabolical forces generally come through not just people, but through their false teachings. False teachers with false teachings who are na-na-na-na embraced as if it was nothing. They don't seem to be false. Keep in mind, they don't walk into the church with a big F on their forehead or on their lapel saying false teacher. No, they look like they're speaking the truth. And because we don't know the Word of God well enough, we fall prey to their false teachings. Charles Spurgeon said that avowed atheists are not a tenth as dangerous as those preachers who scatter doubt and stab at faith. How often are we so afraid of, oh, atheism is growing in America? And it is. The number of people who actually go to church now in America is dropping significantly and rapidly, and we're alarmed. Maybe we should be. I'm not sure. Because this is why I say I'm not sure. Because if you're truly a believer, you will want to be in God's house. Alistair Begg notes that the church collapses from within, not without. My friends, we do not have to concern ourselves with what the world says about Christ. What we have to concern ourselves with is what professing Christians say about Christ. That's key. And so there's the purpose of the book of Jude. Let's take a look now at the author. Verse 1, we know it is Jude because he tells us so. Jude, that's his name. Jude is the English version of the Greek Judas, which is the Judas is the Greek, and the Hebrew is Judah. So you have Jude, Judas, Judah, all referring to the same name. So this book can just as easily be called the Book of Judas. But that doesn't ring well in our ears, does it? Because of Iscariot. It would be like naming your child Adolf. You wouldn't do that. In fact, I think in Germany it's still illegal to do that. And so we use the name Jude instead. There are 8 people in the New Testament by the name of Jude. So which Jude wrote this book? Well, take a look at the text. Let's see what we can discover there. Here, Jude identifies himself as the brother of James. Who's James? Well, this is the James that is nicknamed James the Just, a name that distinguishes him from the other James in the Bible, and one that speaks of his character as well. That's a pretty good name, right? To be nicknamed James the Just, that says something about you. James, by the way, is also a very common New Testament name. James is the English for the Hebrew Jacob. And what we have here is that Jude identifies himself as the brother of Pastor James that leads the Jerusalem Council recorded in Acts chapter 15, verse 13. But Jude also identifies himself not only as the brother of James, but also a servant of Christ. If you go back to verse 1 there, He makes mention, though, that though he is the servant of Christ, James is the brother of Christ. Which means, then, that Jude is also the brother of Christ. He's one of the 4. Christ had at least 2 sisters and 4 brothers. How do we know? Well, the Bible tells us so. Matthew 13, verse 55 tells us he had 4 brothers by the name of James, Joseph, Simon, and then there was Judas. So Jude was Christ's little brother, apparently, if that is in order. I want you to see here Jude's humility. Jude's humility. He does not say, well, listen to me, I'm writing to you because I am Christ's youngest brother. That's not what he says. He does not say, well, I grew up with Jesus, you need to listen to me. By extension, then, I'm more important than the rest of you. No, he makes his identity very sure. He says, I am the brother of Pastor James, the leader of the Jerusalem Council, a pastor who is recognized as just, but I am a servant of Jesus Christ. He identifies his brother's bloodline. He identifies with his brother's bloodline. But he does not identify with the bloodline of Jesus Christ. Instead, he points out Christ's divinity, superiority. He says, I am a servant of Jesus Christ. An equal of James, but a servant to Jesus. I have the right to speak. Why? Because I'm a servant of Christ. I have the right to speak, and it would be wise for you to listen. Why? Because I am related to James. James does keep me in check, but I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. I wonder how many of us would do the same thing, right? If you were actually the brother of Jesus Christ, the sister of Christ, how many of you would have started your letter by saying your name and say the sibling of Jesus Christ, just to get some recognition, just to get a firm standing? Let's take it from there. I think most of us would be at least tempted to do that. Not Jude. You see here a significant humility. Now, recall that he has every reason to be humble. Why? Well, first of all, he is human. But recall as well that none of the brothers of Christ came to a saving knowledge of Christ until after the resurrection. John chapter 7, verse 5, we read the following. Not even his brothers believed in him. In fact, they thought he was kind of wacky. They thought he was really way out there. They were trying to rein him in and say, Jesus, you can't do that. The people are going to think strange things about you if you keep calling yourself the Messiah, if you keep saying you and the Father are one. But after the resurrection, they realize that Big Brother was God. That's why he never got spanked. That's why he never did anything wrong. Now it's all coming to them. They're beginning to understand that he said he would resurrect, and indeed he does. And so when we come to Acts chapter 1 at verse 14, we find all the disciples worshiping and praying to the ascended Christ along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and guess who else? The brothers of Jesus. Now we don't know if it's all four or two or three, but the brothers of Jesus are there, now also believing. They are converted, they are born again, and they become followers of their big brother, but not as big brother, but as their God, their Savior. So Jude says, a servant of Christ, the brother of James. Well, let me address just one more introductory point this morning. I want you to consider the audience that Jude writes to, the audience. It's difficult to put a date on this letter. We don't know exactly when it was written. Neither do we know where Jude was when he wrote it. However, scholars place a date on this letter of around the year 60-65 AD, which would be about 30 years after the crucifixion. This means that Jude would likely be in his mid to late 50s when he wrote it. Considering maybe he was around 20 years old when Christ was crucified, 30 years later he would be somewhere in his 50s. He's a seasoned Christian man. He's obviously someone who is passionate about the church. He's also passionate about truth. He's passionate about doctrine. And because of the form of Greek, the New Testament is written in Greek, and as you know, language changes depending on when and where it's being spoken. Based on the kind of Greek that he is using here, we have not only that date, but we see that he is heavily influenced by the Greek culture. So it is possible that Jude is living in a very Hellenistic or very Greek setting. Maybe he's living in the northwest portion of Israel, which was called the Decapolis, 10 cities, and that was highly influenced by the Greek culture. Maybe, by the way, that would be the West Bank today. Maybe he's living even beyond that. We don't know. Remember Eunice, Timothy's mother, highly influenced by the Greek culture. She lived in Ephesus, or at least we believe that's where Timothy was from, highly influenced by that culture. We don't know for sure, but we do see this Greek influence in the way that he writes and his choice of words. We do not know all the details that, well, many people would want to know, but we know enough to be able to understand the letter and to understand what it means for us today and how to apply it today. We also know that in all the historical records that we have of places and times and things of the New Testament, the name of Jude only comes up once, only once in church history. And it comes up once, not because of Jude directly, but because of his two grandsons. Around the year 80 AD, his grandsons are arrested and interrogated by the Roman emperor. And they're being interrogated for the potential of treason. And in being interrogated, his grandsons explain that they belong to a different kingdom. And of course, to the Roman emperor, this could mean treason. They say, we belong to the kingdom of Christ, a kingdom that will be fully in existence at the end of the age. A kingdom that is here, but not yet. And the emperor then looks at these two young men and dismisses them as just peasants who place no threat to the royal Roman throne. And so it appears that we have then three generations in Jude's family following after Christ. We have Jude and apparently his son, and then the grandsons following Christ. Isn't that wonderful? Three generations of faith. And so we have James the Just, but we have Jude, the legacy of Christian faith. Jude's original audience is not specified. But just as this letter spoke to the early church, again, so it speaks to this present modern church. It speaks to the importance of what is believed. It speaks to the importance of knowing what we believe, both then as well as now. We live in a day in which people are running from doctrine. In fact, they say doctrine divides. Oh, doctrine is boring. My friends, if you're getting your understanding of the Bible from the History Channel or from National Geographic, you're in trouble. Don't listen to them. Go to the scriptures, and there are much better sources for you to learn what the Bible says, what the Bible means. And the church pulpit should always be explaining those truths. Doctrine is essential. There is no shortage of quality books out there written by able Christians who help us to grasp the Bible, develop a proper Christian worldview, books that help us to put our faith into daily practice. And we also have marvelous radio preachers. Yes, there are bad ones, but there are many great preachers who very correctly, very knowledgeably open the Word of God and exposit the Word of God for us, and we can learn from them. And in today's world, we also have many, many podcasts that can help us understand the Word of God as they discuss in 15, 20, 30 minutes, different topics that we can certainly learn from. But honestly, the job of teaching doctrine is first and foremost your pulpit. How should you be learning doctrine? From your church, from your pulpit. We need our pulpits to teach the Bible, to teach doctrine, more doctrine. The church in America is rapidly expanding. Unfortunately, it is only now an inch deep and a mile wide. Why? Because we don't want to understand the Bible, we just want to experience God. We concern ourselves more with what the gospel means to me or what is it worth to me instead of understanding what the gospel is and appreciating the gospel for what it is. And in order to experience the gospel and make us feel better, what do? We set aside doctrine because many people just feel, oh, this is too deep, this is too heavy, this is too burdensome, this is too hard. I just want to love Jesus. I hope you do want to love Jesus, but you can't love Jesus outside of his truth. Otherwise, you're not going to be really loving him. You're going to be loving your imagination of him. I can't tell you how many times I do premarital counseling, only to discover that they're really not in love with each other. they love the person they imagine each other to be. And then when they get married, they say, whoa, hold it. That's not who I married. I say, well, yes, it is. My friends, in order to love Jesus truly, you must truly know him through his word. And that is called doctrine. And doctrine is beautiful. Doctrine soothes you. Doctrine lifts you. Doctrine is your anchor. It will keep you stable when times are hard. And if they're not hard right now, beware, it's coming. It always does. We set aside doctrine, biblical truth, and we want an experience instead. And unfortunately, around the country, week after week, Sunday after Sunday, we offer people an orchestrated experience, and we call it church. We would rather feel better than to know better, which makes us susceptible to false teachings, which will destroy you, and eventually it'll destroy your church. Feelings will not carry you through the hard times, and God's deep and solemn truths will. We are Jude's audience, the modern church, us. And so we must contend for the faith. That doesn't mean that we have to Christianize America. No. That doesn't mean that we have to bring prayer back into the schools, although I think the schools would really benefit from that, Christian prayer. But that's not what the book here is calling for. The book here is calling for us as Christians to believe what Christians believe, the scriptures. It's talking about us knowing what the Word of God says about God and about this great salvation that he has given to us. We are to know God's Word, we are to know what we believe, and then we are to defend it against those who would either deny it or sully it or defame it. And we are to defend it against those who would try to replace it. Not those who are outside the church, but those who are inside the church who would try to replace the Word of God. We're not fighting against government and secular society. We're talking about false teachers in the Church of Christ. And you do not need to be a Bible scholar in order to know God's Word. In fact, my friends, you don't even need to be intelligent. And if you know me well enough, you know that to be true. You don't need to be intelligent in order to know God's word, to understand God's word. This is what you need to do. First, you need to know Christ and possess his Holy Spirit, who will illumine your mind so that you can understand his word. You need to start there. You need to place your faith in Christ. Know him as your Savior. You will be given the Holy Spirit, and he will help you to comprehend his own word. And then you need to begin to love the word of God and value the gospel for what it is, not simply for what it will do for you or to you, but value the gospel because of what it is. And listen, you need to sit under proper, accurate, thorough, routine teaching of God's word. Ongoingly. And you also need to consume his word. Let me advise you to take advantage of when his word is being taught. You cannot consume enough. Somebody left jelly beans downstairs. I had too many this week. There are certain things we should not be consuming too much of. But I'm afraid we like our jelly beans more than we like our doctrine. My friends, let me encourage you, let me advise you to consume God's word and take advantage of when God's word is being taught so that you can learn and know. And there you will be revived. You need to put what you learn into practice. Again, as I said last week, wisdom is not simply knowledge. Wisdom is the application of knowledge, right? And so you need to put these truths into practice. It becomes how you live. It becomes the foundation of your decisions. The truth of the gospel has been declared conclusively. In the ministry of Christ, in the death, in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And what we see in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2, is that in these last days, Christ has spoken, and the revelation is complete, and he will not reveal any more truth to us until he comes again. Jude closes his letter. Look at that last verse, verse 24. He closes this letter, his letter, with a benediction. A benediction is a prayer of blessing on our behalf. He says, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy." And he goes on, right? The truth is that we cannot have great joy. We cannot be presented to God without blemish. We cannot be kept from stumbling through life outside of these great doctrines, outside of these great truths. And I understand your heart. These are the things we all want. We want great joy. We want to be able to stand before God without blemish. We want to be able to say, "I did not stumble through life." But that will not happen unless you know the Word of God and you consume it and you thrive in it. All this will be yours by knowing the Word of God and putting it into practice. And so we venture into the book of Jude to contend for the faith. Now, you read it. There's some pretty hard parts there, isn't there? You're probably going to watch me squirm as I preach. I think I'm going to watch you squirm as you listen. These are imperatives for the Christian life. But we will learn together, and we will contend for the faith as one people. Our Lord and Savior, we thank you because of the boldness of your word, the declarations that you make in your scriptures. We pray that we would know them, that we would love them, that we would consume them, and that we would live them out and insist on them. In your name we pray, amen. On the first Sunday of every month, we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And in order to do that, let me turn your attention to what we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Give me a moment to get there. First Corinthians 11, beginning at verse 17. Gives us here a description of the Lord's Supper as well as what God intends for us to do with the Lord's Supper. Not only why, but how. It reads this way. Let me begin at verse 23 instead. "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats of the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves, truly we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. I'll read on. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give direction when I come. Well, let's take a few moments to reflect on what we just heard and what we just read, and to see, Lord, where do I stand before you? It is a wonderful thing to know Christ is your Savior. It's a wonderful thing to be able to live for Christ on a daily basis. But we all have those moments, those episodes in life in which we don't. Let me encourage you then to reflect on your own situation. Do you know Christ as your Lord and Savior? And are you living for Christ as your Lord and Savior? If you are in these days ignoring Christ, you need to repent. You need to confess and repent before taking part in the Lord's Supper. And let me encourage you then, in the moments we have here, to consider your own heart, your own situation, and if you need to confess, then confess along with repentance. But examine your hearts as we prepare for the Lord's Supper. Let's do that now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving of yourself to us and making a covenant promise with us that you will be our God and we will be your people. For promising to us, Lord, that you would never forsake us, you would never leave us. And for giving us even the assurance that you will correct us, discipline us, so as not to condemn us with the world. Thank you, Lord. For your goodness is an aroma to our souls. We thank you, Lord, because your goodness is reflected in so many ways. We see it daily. We are so accustomed to it, at times it goes ignored. We thank you, Lord, for lavishing on us your care and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for overflowing in us your grace that beckons us and forgives us evermore. We thank you, Lord, for having shed your body on the cross on our behalf. And we worship you this hour. Amen. Christ converted the Passover into the Lord's Supper. And he said, "This is my bread, which is for you. Take it, eat it together in memory of him." Let me pray. Our Lord and Savior, we thank you for you have shed your life, and in shedding your life, you even poured out your blood. There's no question, O Lord, that you died indeed. As blood ran through from your side, as the blood spilled from your forehead, as your blood was drained from your body through your hands and feet, you were sacrificing yourself on our behalf, being our atonement. Thank you, Lord, for being our substitute, for your willingness to suffer on our behalf, to pay for our sins, a sin that you never knew experientially. They became yours. And thank you, Lord, that you've given to us a righteousness that we've never known ourselves, your righteousness. And for that, we praise you and worship you. Amen. And he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Let us drink together." Let's join together in prayer. Our Lord and our God, O Christ, we come to you together. And we recognize that indeed you are the way, the truth, and the life. And that no one comes to God the Father but by you. Your words are certain. Your words are true. And we are living testimonies of your truth. We ask, O God, that you would stir us to call on you to be a people of prayer, but also a people who are willing to confess those things that often escape our minds, to confess that often we wander from you. Our hearts tend to chase after pleasures, and we neglect you. Our days are full, and it seems like our time is short, and at times we live as if you do not live. We pray, O Lord, that you would change us and mold us so that that would not be the common practice and even no longer a practice in us. We approach you this morning, O Lord, as our Father and our friend. You are our portion. You alone restore our joy. You give us strength. You are the God of nature, the choreographer of providence, the one who will set the moon and the sun in its course tomorrow. You are the sender of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Our guilt is removed because of your resurrection. Amen, O God. And the sting of death is taken away in the promise of eternal life that you give to all those who place their faith in you. Remind us of what you have taught us in the past. Illuminate our minds so that we may know more of you. We pray, O God, that today, on this day, you will comfort those who are in our midst who are broken. That you will give vision to those who work on your behalf. Strengthen those who are weak. Give boldness to your followers. Emblaze us with passion for your church. Teach us to love your doctrines. As the days grow dark and the world rebels against you, teach us, Lord, to love your word. Uphold us, Lord, we ask, with your word. Encourage us. And we pray, Lord, that no longer would sin dominate us. Teach us that Christ cannot be the way if we are the end. Teach us, Lord, that he cannot be the Redeemer until we realize our need for redemption. Teach us, Lord, that there can be no union with Christ until he captures our hearts and we place our faith in him. Help us then, Lord, to find pleasure in this straight and narrow path that you have placed us on, and to know the constant joy that comes from the salvation you give to us. Lord, we pray once again for Amanda. We ask, Lord, that you would protect her body. Protect the babies, those two babies in her womb, those two little girls in her womb. We ask, O Lord, that they would be healthy, that she would be healthy. Protect Mike as he prepares and trains for the work that he will be doing in defending and protecting our nation on the streets of Manhattan. We pray, Lord, for others in our midst who are ill, some severely, some emotionally. Lord, we pray that your healing hand would be evident to them, that they would be able to say, it is well with my soul, and Lord, even it is well with my body. We pray for your healing. Give them strength to endure, and may their suffering, even their suffering, be a testimony of your grace and your upholding and your training. We pray these things in your good name, O God. Amen. Let's stand together. And let's sing once again. Meanwhile, if you will, please send the cups to the middle. Mike will collect them. And keep in mind, on this first Sunday of the month, we collect a second offering, and that is a benevolence offering. It is for monies for people in our community or in our church who are in need of any financial assistance.
is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. His oldest covenant is blood. Support me in the whelming flood. When all around Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Trust in his righteousness alone. Faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone. Weak made strong in the Savior's love.
Let's pray. Our Lord and our God, we pray your blessing as we leave here this morning. May we know the joy of your presence. May we know the beauty of your mercy and, Lord, the guidance of your Holy Spirit in our lives. May this be a week that we all rejoice in you and know the beauty, the favor of God on our side. Amen.